As the years come and go, only forever, if you care to know, would I grant all your wishes and be proud of the task, only forever. If someone should ask, how long would it take me to be near if you beckon? Offhand, I would figure less than a second. Do you think I'll remember how you looked when you smiled? Only forever, that's putting it mild.
Testing? Can everybody hear me okay? Okay. I feel like I've been talking nonstop for like the last 45 minutes, so I'm going to drink some water before I start officially talking, if you'll bear with me. Okay. So, good evening. Why don't you say something really quick, just so that we make sure that our, we've got the levels right. Whatever you want. Okay. Can everybody hear that okay? Okay. Super. Louder? Okay. Let's we'll just ratchet it up a bit here. There? How's that? Oh. Oh, you're right. Oh, it's flip the there's a switch on the top. This is what it's going to be like the entire time.
I'm just being difficult. All right.
There's a.
Now it works.
Now you sound like the voice of God calling.
I am the voice of God.
Okay. So, good evening, everyone. And thank you for joining us for this special presentation of the University of Illinois Alumni Association and the Chez Veterans Center called Unsung Heroes of World War II, the American Red Cross Clubmobile Service. I'm Ryan Ross. I'm the Alumni Association's Director of History and Traditions Programs, Senior Editor of Illinois Alumni Magazine, and the Curator and Collections Manager of the U of I's Heritage Museum, the Richmond Family Welcome Gallery, which is just right up there. I'm gonna be your moderator for this evening's conversation with Luis Alberto Urrea to talk about World War II and the Clubmobile Service and his historical novel, Goodnight, Irene. Luis is the author of 16 previous books, ranging from novels and short story collections to memoirs, journalism, poetry, and essays. He does all of these things, and he does them all equally well. Were you created in a lab?
Yes.
Okay. His landmark book, The Devil's Highway, about a group of 26 men trying to cross the border from Mexico into the United States, was a finalist for the 2005 Pulitzer Prize for Nonfiction, and is now in its 34th printing. Luis is the son of a Mexican father and an American mother, and grew up in both Tijuana and San Diego. And the majority of his work focuses on the experiences of Mexicans and Mexican Americans, as well as the US-Mexican border. Goodnight, Irene centers on the experiences of Irene and Dorothy, two women in the Clubmobile service during World War II. The character of Irene is based on his mother, Phyllis McLaughlin Urrea, and Dorothy is based on Phyllis's best friend in the war, a lady named Jill Pitts-Knappenberger, who was an Illinois native who graduated from the U of I in 1950 and then lived in Champaign for most of the next 70 years and was a marvelous lady.
Yeah.
Which we will talk about. And so that was my introduction of you, and I'm just going to jump right into things.
Okay.
Okay. So you open the novel with this epigraph that's from an anonymous World War II letter quoted in Marjorie Lee Morgan's book, The Clubmobile, The Ark and the Storm. And after I finished your book, I read the epigraph again, and it seemed like either Irene or Dorothy could have written it. And it reads, "Some think we're so brave, but we really don't know enough to be scared. Some people think we're brats. Some of us are. Some think we'd be better off at home, where a woman's place used to be about 200 years ago. Some stare, shake their heads in disbelief. Some cheer, some scream and wave. Everybody greets us. Some wolf, some worship, some think you're human, and some don't. You're a Red Cross girl. You're on the chow and charm circuit. You're a griping, kidding GI. Your personality on legs," which is my favorite part. So I think that's a perfect introduction to the Clubmobile service, and that it's a good place for us to start.
Okay.
So before we start talking about your mother and Jill, could you tell us a bit about what the Clubmobile service was and the role that it played in World War II?
Well, yeah. So the Clubmobile was exactly what you'd think. It was a club on wheels. And it's interesting, when the book was about to come out, you know, the hype machine kicked in, and I was given assignments over and over. Yeah, right. New York Times op-ed, Time Magazine op-ed, Good Housekeeping op-ed. I thought, okay, my mom loved Good Housekeeping. That's good. She'd be happy. And so the first one that came out was the one for the New York Times, and it came out in their electronic version, and I started getting calls and emails that it had 500 responses at about the first hour and a half, which was fascinating to me. And a lot of people whose moms or grandmothers or auntie or whatever had been there. But there were mansplainers. Nothing against my brothers here. I love you all. But, you know, those women were so far in the rear, they didn't even hear a gun go off, you know. And I was so mad. And I thought, don't tell Jill this. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I did a little karma battle with those guys. But essentially, the Clubmobile Corps was in charge of clubs, officers' clubs, and, you know, enlisted men's clubs. And yes, those were in the rear. Mm-hmm. And one of the gentlemen from the Red Cross got the idea that it would be interesting to make it mobile and took it to Eisenhower, who thought that was a great idea. And so they designed these trucks. You see pictures of the trucks. Mm-hmm. 2.5-ton GMC truck, 6-wheel drive, a 6x. And they built a galley on the back. And in the galley, there's even a blueprint that shows up in the slides. They put in 2 huge coffee makers, water tanks, an electric donut maker, a basically cauldron of grease and oil.
They could have used that in the fighting.
They could have. And they made thousands of donuts a day. And the Red Cross would send supply trucks with the mix already ready. They would throw it in, and the water buffalo trucks would come and refill their tanks. And just if you have read the book or are going to read the book or are interested, or listen to the audio, because the woman who acted it out is unbelievable. Teddy is her name. I love her. But anyway, I thought it'd be stupid to have me trying to make believe I was 100 women. No.
I think you could have done it.
I've done it before, thanks, for other books. But I just thought, no, this book was so special to me. Yeah. I wanted it to be perfect. But so they, just so you know, everything that happens to Irene in the novel is chronologically what happened to my mother. And there's a terrible, horrible injury at the end. That was true. But they trained. They went from all over the country to Washington, D.C., trained, went through a kind of a Donut Dolly boot camp there. And they went to the Brooklyn shipyards and then came across the ocean. Uh-huh. This particular batch ended up in Liverpool. And the first service that they did was in Liverpool, meeting troops coming off the ships. And one of the things that happens, my mom had my mom had a totally different reaction to what happened than Jill did. Those of you who knew Jill had it together. And, you know, and she was ordered. My mother was blown up by it. But one thing that Jill did was save all the correspondence, all the letters. So there are many letters in the book that are, you know, cribbed from Jill's. But they did the service there, and then they were sent to London, and they were sent on a train, and the train was bombed. Welcome to World War II.
Yeah.
And they got to London, and they did service at the Grosvenor Hotel, which was the officers' mess. Ernie Pyle used to eat there.
Yeah.
Hemingway ate there.
Ernie Pyle ate almost nothing there.
Ernie Pyle did not like food, and they were angry. They were like, because you had to eat American style.
Yeah.
It was the whole thing that you had to eat tons of food.
It was an order.
It kind of was.
Yeah.
And Ernie didn't want to eat much, so they were offended.
Mm-hmm.
And then they were sent to Glatton Air Base in Cambridgeshire, which was a bomber base, B-17 base, and they lived in the village nearby, 3 miles from the field. And one little story that cropped up that I didn't realize, I put it in the book, was that at the next bombing base, there were all these Yank bases all over the northeast of England. Clark Gable was at the next. And I thought, there's no way Jill and my mom wouldn't try to meet Clark Gable.
Yeah.
So I just have the two characters that they inspired drive over to the base and sort of lounge around at the gate, hoping he'll drive by.
And he never did.
No, he didn't. And then they were shipped to the war, and they landed on Utah Beach.
Yeah.
And they drove hither thither all through, you know, northern France, Western mm-hmm. Europe. And it's hard to believe, but these women took part in the liberation of Paris, mm-hmm. liberation of Brussels. They were trapped in the siege of Bastogne. They were caught when the Germans broke through, Battle of the Bulge. They got a citation for being Jill. Come on, Jill. The most forward women in combat mm-hmm. in World War II.
Yeah.
And then they followed Patton to Weimar, and they made an actual, they parked the truck and made a club in Weimar, and Patton came in, causing sheer panic. And he said, I'm gonna need your help tomorrow. We're gonna go up the mountain. It's a prison camp. And they thought they were American POWs. They thought, oh, it's our boys. And so they liberated Buchenwald.
Yeah.
This is craziness.
I've heard you talk about how your mother, she had a footlocker. They gave the Clubmobile women footlockers just like all the other soldiers got. And when you were a kid, you found these photos
mm-hmm.
from Buchenwald?
Yes. So, though they were Red Cross volunteers, the Army gave them rank. Mm-hmm. So, on paper, they were lieutenants in the Army, and some of them were captains, in the hopes that the Germans, if they were captured, would honor the Geneva Convention. Uh-huh. It was a gallant move. But when then being lieutenants, they got their footlockers. Everyone, my mom's was too big to bring, but I've got it. You know, Mom, we can talk about this responses to the trauma, but she gradually separated herself from all of her life, mm-hmm. including Jill. And when you step out there, there's a picture of my mother off Jill's wall, signed to Jill. But she lost track of my mom in 1954, which is how my mom ended up living in Mexico with my dad.
Yeah.
When we left Mexico, lived in Southeast San Diego in an apartment, which yeah. was hell to my mother. I mean, dear boy, that's how she, if she were here, she'd say, oh, dear boy, you're so charming. and she liked to show her rings. You are so interesting. So she set we had a terrible little apartment, and she set the footlocker in the living room uh-huh. and put a little cloth over it.
Yeah.
And she had a blown glass duck, I believe it was, that she got from green stamps or blue chip stamps. And, you know, no one touched this. Uh-huh. No. And she would tell me, dear boy, we're not touching mother's box, are we? No, Mom. And one day I was in fourth grade, and she left for work, and I thought, Dad's asleep. Mom's gone. Right? You know what it's like being a kid.
Oh, yeah.
And I put the duck on the floor very carefully, and I took the cloth off, and I opened it, and it was full of treasure, dude. She had a combat jacket that had the patch of every, you know, the Third Army, the uh-huh. you know, the all these, the gentlemen from hell, the, you know, all these groups that she had attended to. They would give the patches to the women. And so she had sewn it on the jacket. Uh-huh. And there was stuff that she had requisitioned from various Nazi desks. And I've said this before, and I don't know if it's true, but I remember vividly, I think there was a Luger in there that she stole. And there were all these things and photographs. Mm-hmm. A lot of the pictures you're seeing or were seeing in the slideshow were hers, and pictures of the women, her partners, yeah. And pictures of bombers, all this amazing stuff. Uh-huh. There's a picture of Patton. And it was all great, except at the bottom were her Buchenwald pictures. And I opened it, and there were I still have them. I'm not sure what to do with them yet, but there were pictures of naked, slaughtered, skeletal men everywhere. Stacks and piles of them. And, you know, I just thought, this is, I don't know, something's wrong. You know, and I put it back together, and I put everything back, and I closed it, and I put all the duck on it and all that sort of thing. And I just prayed, you know, don't let her figure out I got in the box, because I didn't know what happened.
Yeah.
And she came home, and again, note to my brothers here, women are psychic. And she walked in and she said, we opened the box, didn't we? I said, no. And she sat me down, and I've never forgotten the conversation, and she said, did you see photographs? I said, yeah. Did you see the bad ones? I said, yes. So she said, you know, I want to tell you about this. Fourth grade is a weird time to find out what the world is like. And she said a lot of things I won't repeat that were very difficult. But what she did say was she had her camera with her. And when she saw this, she felt that she needed to take pictures of it. And as she was going around taking the pictures of all this stuff, she felt ashamed and stopped. And I think my first introduction to her haunting was, ever since that day, I've been ashamed that I didn't take more pictures. And one of the reasons was, when she came back, wounded, crippled, you know, legs wired together, went back to New York to her little society family and so forth, and they didn't believe her. They told her, oh, you're exaggerating. And I think she realized, the only thing she would say was, New York was no longer New York. And some friends of hers, several of the Donut Dollies or Red Cross nurses, moved to the West Coast. And they loved the San Francisco area, and they cajoled her to join them. So that began her journey, but that journey meant cutting things off, her past, more and more and more, which now we know is a, you know, can be a symptom of battle fatigue or PTSD.
Sure.
Yeah.
So you've written about your mother previously in your nonfiction a little bit, sometimes at length. And
thank you. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Oh. So we're fading in and out.
Let's do that.
Okay.
Oh, that's right. I should put it on his side. Since my head's... Okay. Thanks for the tip, y'all.
Wow, that should work really well.
Okay. How is that?
That's fabulous.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Life is just a learning process. Okay. Right. So I was starting to say, you've written about your mother a fair amount in your nonfiction, and there's this line near the beginning of your book, By the Lake of Sleeping Children, that sums up the woman that you knew, that you portray in your essays and memoir. And you wrote, my mother was a socialite from Manhattan who had recently returned from being seriously wounded in World War II, a Red Cross frontline donut and coffee girl who entered Buchenwald with the GIs and in some ways never came out. And earlier this year you wrote in an essay that, quote, the entire novel came from hearing her nightmares every night, from her footlocker full of pictures, and the way she turned into Greta Garbo when she smoked, which I love, and replied to any wit at all with a swoony, oh, darling.
Oh, darling.
So it was fascinating to compare those portrayals to the character of Irene before the war changes her and PTSD comes to have such a huge impact on her life. So I'm wondering, in what ways did creating this fictional character help you gain a better understanding of your mother?
You know, it was very painful, very difficult. it was fraught, mm-hmm. as many people with combat experience or combat experienced relatives can tell you. It can be difficult. And she didn't have nightmares when I was a little kid, but by the time I was in sixth grade on, they got worse and worse and worse.
Huh.
And she would spend the nights actually crying out in terror. And you couldn't touch her, you couldn't help her, or she would. So I've often said this, you can find it in various interviews, but it's true that I was a teenage insomniac. I couldn't sleep through that.
Uh-huh.
And you know, I'd be sitting up in my bedroom on the floor with Leonard Cohen, listening to his records. And sooner or later, you're going to get a little notebook. I mean, you know, you absorb, because of course it was Bob Dylan and Jim Morrison. I thought, I'm going to get leather pants and be Jim Morrison.
I think only Jim Morrison can be Jim Morrison.
Yeah, only, thank God. But yeah, so, you know, and I was enamored of stories. My mother and my father had a culture war, mm-hmm. because you probably know this because you know everything, but my mother called me Lewis, and Miss Jill called me Lewis. Not that Luis crap, you know. They were practical. Lewis.
Uh-huh.
And my mother would tell me, and I don't know why you're so obsessed with being a Mexican. And I was like, you're the only American I know. And why did you have me in Mexico? And why did you name me Luis?
Yeah.
You know, it was a weird thing.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody was fascinated by her. And it became my job to keep her hoping, to entertain her.
Mm-hmm.
She loved outrageous humor, Marx Brothers kind of crazy things. And so I figured out, probably by junior high, that if I found weird clothes in her closet or whatever and dressed up and came out into the living room as though I was her, hello, darling. She'd light right up.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was harder and harder to keep her up.
Mm-hmm.
So it was, well, like I said, all the events in the book are biographically what happened to her.
Yeah.
Polished or changed here and there to make fiction. Uh-huh. But also, you know, my mom's middle name was Irene. That's how close it is to her.
Mm-hmm. So earlier when you were talking about some of the events that the characters of Irene and Dorothy experienced, that, you know, your mom and Jill really experienced, what, you know, and crazy things like the train being bombed and that bombing in London. And
my mom saw the first buzz bomb.
Yeah. I mean, knowing that they actually experienced that stuff, what impact did that have on you writing about it?
Well, it's you know, it's really a strange thing to be a callow Southern California dude and realize that your mom is in fact not square at all, but a war hero.
Uh-huh.
What? And my dad was a Mexican military man,
mm-hmm.
and I realized he was insanely jealous of her because she was four times the hero he had ever been. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And this seems tangential, but it's not. So when I was in college, I wanted to be an author. I was a drama major and a writing major, and I gave up the drama and stuck with the writing.
Uh-huh.
And the person who discovered me and published my first story was Ursula K. Le Guin, the science fiction genius. And she took me under her wing. And she told me when I was 22 years old one day, she used to call me Luisito. And she said to me one day out of the blue, Luisito, it's time for us to become feminists. And I was like, huh? What? And I said, how do I do that? And she said, you will begin by, from now on, taking women's literature courses. Anything Ursula said. So yep. Here came Doris Lessing, you know, here came Willa Cather, here came mm-hmm. all these, and it changed things for me. But then I was answerable to Ursula all the time.
Yeah.
You know, and so she was interested in this business with my mom. I wish she could have seen the book. Mm-hmm. I definitely was thinking about her and her eye and, you know, be sure you're telling the truth as best you can.
Yeah.
While lying through fiction.
Sure. Well, sometimes, you know, the truth is more true than the facts.
Oh, I think so. Yeah, because one of the things you can do in a novel, as soon as, and I by the way, I just want to say this, make no mistake, the donut dollies are heroes, not just war heroes. And though the World War II women are all gone, there's some Vietnam donut dollies right here, my heroes. We love you. And we can talk about this later. My experience meeting the Vietnam donut dollies was hair-raising. It was amazing. But it's a recalibration of what you think. And to know, I'm sure you know this, but the record building burned down for the Red Cross. So honestly, a lot of the women were gone with the wind. Mm-hmm. And you know, now the Red Cross, they sent me a pin in honor of my mom. It's a, you know, they sent me a Washington, D.C. certificate. And now they want me to come lecture the actual Red Cross about the history. Mm-hmm. Because it's so long ago that, you know.
It's gone.
It's gone.
In a lot of ways.
Yeah.
So before we get into anything else, I was going to ask you, so how did you meet Jill Knappenberger? And what sort of relationship did you have with her?
Brother, it was the hand of God. It was, seriously, because I thought Jill was gone. Mm-hmm. And there are reasons for this. My wife, who's hiding somewhere in here, is my partner in all things. And, you know, she's a journalist. Mm-hmm. And so when it's time to do research, it's just awesome because I've got this organized mind in my house, unlike me. She comes up with really astonishing things I never thought of, like, how about a timeline? What magic is this? You know? Here are the dates when things happen. What? Uh-huh. And we had gone through a whole lot of projects, and she asked me one night, tell me about your mom. What is the story about your mom? Mm-hmm. I said, that's a donut dolly. Yeah, and?
Uh-huh.
I said, you know the donut dollies? Red Cross. And I said, you know, come on, the donut dollies. And they drove a 2.5-ton truck into combat making donuts. And she said, what? And I thought, right? Oh. And so we started researching. She's the research monster. You know, I was doing what research I could, and I was going through my mom's things, which were very painful to go through. Mm-hmm. And she's writing about Jill and so forth. But there was a moment, not to give away too much, something terrible happened to my mom. Mm-hmm. And there was a woman with her who disappeared. And I thought that person was Jill. And you know, and so I had gone on that thinking that this terrible thing happened. Mm-hmm. And we would periodically go back into the Foot Locker because there's all kinds of amazing stuff in there. You know, a citation from Harry S. Truman.
Yeah.
I was like, dude, we've got Harry S. Truman's autograph, you know, yeah. And she was digging through and she pulls up a typed thing called Miss Jill Goes to War. And she starts reading it, and she says, oh, my, this is Jill. This is Miss Jill. I was like, what? I hadn't seen it. And, you know, it's a little story about Jill's experiences in the war. And we realized, wait a minute, it's dated, you know, like 54, 53. And we mm-hmm. thought, she didn't die? And there was an address label on it, right here.
Yeah.
We live in Naperville.
Uh-huh.
And I thought, no way. There's no way she lives, you know, an hour and a half from our front door. That's not possible.
Uh-huh.
So we thought, well, you know, I'm sure she's gone, but maybe somebody in the family lives, we don't know.
Mm-hmm.
So Cindy wrote her a letter and sent it. And Miss Jill called us. And I didn't want to, I was like, I'm not talking to her. I was too nervous, you know. So Cindy had a nice talk, but she insisted I would like to talk to Lewis. Uh-huh. I thought, oh crap. I said, hi, Miss Jill. I'm so excited to be talking to you. And she said, I didn't know Phyllis had a son. And she asked me what happened to her. I said, well, she passed away in 1990. And she was very thoughtful and pensive. And she said, you must come see me.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, oh, yes, ma'am. We're going to come right away. I'm going to come see you this week. And she said, Lewis, I am 94 years old. Don't try to wait till I turn 95, if you catch my drift. And I thought, dude, I've got a crush on this woman. You know, she's amazing.
And she said stuff like that all the time.
All the time. And so we drove down, and this is where the book came from. There's a roundabout way to answer your question.
Yeah. But
we went to her apartment, and those of you who knew her or visited her there, it was always sort of 1945 in there.
Yeah.
She had music loops. I think that her nephews made, I don't know who made them for her, but all the songs, mm-hmm. including the songs they played in the truck. And she was wonderful. You know, she opened the door. She put her arm through mine. That was my job. I was her beau everywhere we went.
Uh-huh.
And she walked us in, and on the wall, picture of my mom.
Yeah.
In uniform. It's right out there on the chair out
right
there.
Right next to the book signing table.
Yes. And it's signed to Jill and her husband.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just looking at it. You'll know my mom right away because she's doing the pose.
Yeah.
And Jill changed my life because we were standing there looking at it, and she said, I drove the truck, but your mother brought the joy. And you know, you read in the Bible about, you know, scales lifted off your eyes. I thought, she's 27 years old.
Uh-huh.
And it really haunted me. We had a great visit, then we drove back, and as soon as we got home, I went back into the archive to look at the pictures of my mom. And in almost every picture, no matter where they are, she's happy, just glowing. And I realized she knew she was saving the world in her own way.
Uh-huh.
Even there's one, my favorite picture of all of them, you don't have it here, but they're in some European town. You can see the truck behind them. She's with a bunch of GIs. I think she's with a lieutenant.
Yeah.
And they all have cups of coffee. And she's looking almost Chicana. She's like, and I found myself falling in love with my mom, like I was in love with Jill.
Yeah. Wow. So you feel like when you heard that, it just sort of broke the whole book open for you.
It did. It did. And, you know, there was no end of astonishing revelations.
Yeah.
So, you know, and she was so amazing. She was so present. You know, we were with her from 94, you know, basically till she passed away.
Yeah.
And she loved our daughter.
Uh-huh.
You know, she gave us presents all the time. And she had certain rules. She still had, and I think there's a picture in the slideshow, she had and left behind the actual map she used while she drove the truck. And it's got all of her, and she sat with me and she said, look, here, oh, we went, oh, yes, I remember this, you know.
Yeah.
Reading the map to me.
Uh-huh.
And then she said, Lewis, you cannot have this map. I said, no, I don't even want to touch it. You know, this is sacred stuff.
Yeah.
And she you know, we have hours and hours of recordings with her. And honestly, most of it is just belly laughs. We never stopped laughing.
Uh-huh.
And at one point, because I said, there's no trucks. They're all gone. Mm-hmm. I don't know what the configuration was. I don't know anything. And she sat there and she said, well, this carpet's perked near the size of the truck. And then just went off. So the coffee maker was here and here. I'm taking notes. Cindy's crawling around. And she outlined the entire interior of the truck from memory.
Yeah.
And I thought, this is incredible, right? Mm-hmm. That was fabulous. And
she was doing it 70 years later.
Oh, yeah. She knew everything.
Yeah.
And what was different about my mom is, and Jill, was that my mom, it was just a tornado, a jumble. Jill had it down. Mm-hmm. Jill was not impervious to the pain. And what was fascinating, I've never seen anybody do this before. She would be talking and then it would get really heavy. And she'd say, I'm going to be sad now. And she just covered her eyes. And then after it was passed, she'd keep talking.
Yeah.
Which was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And we owe a lot to our friend, wherever she is back here, Nancy Johnson.
With the fabulous jacket.
Yeah, the David Bowie jacket. You know, what was it you guys watched? Was it Jeopardy every day?
With Manhattans.
Jeopardy. Yeah. Oh. Joy juice.
That's right. Yeah.
A Manhattan. And you know what? You know what I loved about her? When we'd go to the country club and everybody knew her and the waitress would come out and say, Miss Jill, you look like you need some joy juice. And she would say, no, no, I don't think so. And then she'd say to her, make it a double.
Yeah, that's pretty much a perfect encapsulation. Of
oh my God. And she would drink it. And I no matter how old she was, as soon as she sipped it, you'd know because her eyebrow would go up. And she'd start looking at us and then start to kind of grin a little bit and then zing people. Boom. Pow. Uh-huh. Boom. And I thought, look at her go.
If she had done stand-up, she would have been the best at crowd work.
I think so.
Yeah.
Unflappable.
So, talking about your mom and Jill, so something that I've noticed about your work in general is that you, in book after book, one of the common themes is the importance of family. And in some of your books, it's blood relatives.
Yeah.
Like The House of Broken Angels and In Search of Snow, whose character Garcia makes a cameo in Goodnight Irene.
Oh, he's the star of the second half.
Oh, yeah.
What cameo, bato? It needed a Mexican.
Well, and you know what I found most fascinating about this is the fact that the things that you see him experience during the war in Goodnight Irene, he also experiences, you know, as flashbacks in Search of Snow.
He waited 31 years to come back and tell his story.
Yeah, I thought that was great. I switched it, flipped it, reversed it. I read Goodnight Irene first and then I read. But anyway.
Nobody's read In Search of Snow. He's completely unknown.
I only did because I'm an insane person and I decided I was just gonna read all your books.
Yeah, you're that one book sale that book did.
A lot of your books, you're talking about blood relatives, but in maybe just as many, you're talking about these created families, like in some cases in Into the Beautiful North, with all the people from the town who come together, and definitely in this book. And Irene and Dorothy definitely become a family.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Even about halfway through, you start referring to them as the sisters.
Mm-hmm.
And that experience that they have is an experience that millions of soldiers had during the war also. And so I wonder if you can talk just a little bit about how you use the inherent complexities of family dynamics as a storytelling device.
Wow. I must be a genius. Dude, I was isolated. Mm-hmm. And so I think I yearned for family and connection. And that was difficult. And I'm one of those people that built family constantly. All of my friends, even from junior high school, still friends now, those who are alive. Mm-hmm. I'm at that odd and terrible time in life where all my dearest friends are gone. They're dying. And that's kind of starts getting really lonely. Mm-hmm. But you know, we have a fabulous family, and it's both a blessing and a curse that our extended families keep moving to Illinois to be near us. Uh-huh. So it was just Cindy and the three kids and me and the stupid dogs, and then, you know, one gets married and has a baby, and then another one gets married. Our Illini drum god, it's our son. Uh-huh. He got married, and then relatives moved in, and they're bringing more relatives of theirs in, and then Cindy's sister Sue moved into our house. I thought, what is happening? Enough family, man. I want to be alone. But that's, you know, that's not to be religious, but I think that's spirit answering your yearning, your sorrow. And, you know, one of the secrets in my family was that it was very matriarchal. Mm-hmm. When I did have family, it was very strong women with men that they allowed to feel like they were in charge of the world. And they let them sort of strut around, and when they left, then they would get back to running everything. Uh-huh. And my grandmother and my aunts were great storytellers. My Aunt Irma was Mexico's first international women's bowling champion.
You can clap. That's a great thing.
Yeah. For y'all bowlers.
And she's also a character in Into the Beautiful North.
She is. They're all, you know.
They're all in there.
Yeah, because you want to give honor to people who were forgotten or not seen or not given the respect. Mm-hmm. That they deserved. So yeah, Into the Beautiful North, especially the House of Broken Angels, are so autobiographical in certain ways. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I know you know this because you've looked at all this stuff, but after I graduated college, I wanted meaning. Because my dad, we won't get into this, but my dad died horribly when I was a senior, which is how Le Guin took me in. I think she felt she was saving a drowning rat. It was a horrible thing. And I didn't know what to do with myself, and I had been so, at that point, separated from the Tijuana experience. Mm-hmm. And I met a pastor, American pastor, who spent all of his life helping the poor in Tijuana. And I went back, and I spent years with him, Tijuana garbage dump, orphanages, and so mm-hmm. forth. And so some of the people that I got to know and love and deal with every day, Barry, mm-hmm. Started coming out in the writing.
Yeah.
And I realized that there were so many people that I would love to memorialize in some way, because most of the people I loved were forgotten or invisible, mm-hmm. or not going to get honored.
Sure.
You know, and some of those things are so personal, I don't know how to express it, but I think it comes out in writing. You know, I tell my writing students, we all have a certain backbeat. We have a rhythm if we're good writers. Mm-hmm. And mine is tortilla makers.
Yeah.
And in the neighborhood I was from, there was a little tortilla stand. Uh-huh. And I think one of the first accomplishments of my life was, you know, when the badass old ladies in the house said, Luisito, go buy some tortillas. And I was allowed to walk up the mean street by myself.
Uh-huh.
And when I walked into that tortilla, and you could hear them down the street, four women, all day,
yeah.
Mexican news radio, or mariachi kind of music.
Mm-hmm.
And I had no idea that being blue-eyed was a big deal. I wanted to be brown. Uh-huh. And I was blonde back then. And I'd walk in, they'd be like, ay, güerito. Oy, mira, güerito. I said, yeah. Yeah. 7-year-old playboy. Uh-huh. And they started feeding me. I thought, okay. You want a fresh tortilla? Sure, yeah. And they'd put salt in it, and then they'd put butter in one, lemon in. I had every kind of tortilla. And I remember, it was a joke in book talks, but I remember thinking, just wait, I'm marrying all four of you. Because I was smitten. Uh-huh. But then you realize that, you know, people not respected, even by the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. That meant a lot to me. And when I realized that I had this thing happening, that I could tell a story, I could keep those people alive, maybe forever.
Mm-hmm. That's really one of the most remarkable things about your first couple of nonfiction books where you're writing about those people, is that reading about them, the entire time I was going, I've never read about people like this before. And so it was all of these different stories about these people and what their daily lives were like just kept blowing my mind over and over again. Because it just kept reminding me that there are lots of different ways to live in the world, and people's experiences are so completely different from your own. And that a lot of these ways of living, you're never going to hear anything about, which is a terrible shame.
I can take you if you want to go.
But I feel like I've been there, though.
Yeah, you know? Well, I'm glad about that. It is shocking, uh-huh. And it is heartrending, but it's also beautiful that, you know, family is family. People do the best they can. Mm-hmm. There are reasons they're there. They're not just attacking the border because they want to take your job or Social Security. You know, one of the women, a Chinanteca, a lot of indigenous people, uh-huh. And she told me, we are here because there's no garbage left. People have even taken the garbage where we're from. So, you know, we're rich here in the trash. And I was the translator. Uh-huh. This pastor, you would have loved this guy. Just to give you a little, I used to tell him he was a Zen Baptist. Because he had this wisdom about him. And he took me into the Tijuana garbage dump. Uh-huh. And I was like, holy crap, you know, this is the apocalypse. It was Mad Max, I thought. And he said, are you humble enough to wash feet?
What did you say?
I was basically thinking, I'll show you who's humble, dude, right? He knew, he had, and he put out an aluminum tub, filled it with hot water, and threw in a bar of Ivory soap. And he said, believe me, you'll thank me later that floats. I thought, okay. And I had to kneel in the garbage. I washed almost 300 people. And I started crying at about person number 5. So, you know, that pastor was a war veteran. He'd been through some hellish experiences in Korea, uh-huh. And he put me through it like a drill instructor. Here's some spiritual boot camp. Can you take it? And that I think that day busted everything open for me. Uh-huh. And later on, I became his translator. He asked me if I would translate for him, and I said, if I got in a pulpit with you, we'd both be hit by lightning. And he said, I would work with the devil himself if it would save the children. So I thought, the devil himself, that's badass, yeah.
It's a good title.
Yeah, well, yeah, maybe I'll use it. So that's what happened. I was with him all the time, mm-hmm. And in Mexico several times a week. Now, my mom, because I had no money, I was still living at my mom's house, mm-hmm. She became, without my understanding it, Clubmobile woman immediately. She collected jugs of water from all the neighbors, filled them at the hose. Every Thursday, she had gallons of water for the poor. She would collect clothes from everybody, ready to go.
Yeah.
You know, she would have sent donuts if she could.
Uh-huh.
And she was so happy. The other thing you'll appreciate is my first paying job was as a donut cook. And she never explained why that was hilarious.
The universe is just filled with these beautiful ironies.
Yeah, it is.
It just keeps giving.
It does, but you don't always know. And that was a very difficult time, you know, and very challenging. You saw a lot of awfulness. But that pastor, there had been, we would part of what we do is distribute clothing.
Uh-huh.
But you had to have absolute discipline, because you can imagine a mom with children, no food, no clothes, no diapers. If somebody started tossing out Pampers, it would be a riot. And some idiot got on top of the van and started throwing Pampers, and all hell broke loose. And I was the only translator I was trying to keep.
Yeah.
And it got so crazy that I just took off. And I went walking out, and people kept pigs in the garbage.
Mm-hmm.
And I was standing at a pig pen just losing it. And the pastor wandered out, and he was, you know, he had the genius of a good military leader. Look at that. Look at that pig.
Uh-huh.
Look, the mom's sitting on the pig. You ever see anything like that? Completely distracting me.
Uh-huh.
And then he said, you know, nobody who writes books has been with these people, lived amongst them. You should do it. And I looked at him, because I wanted to be Stephen King. You know? Uh-huh. I wanted to make $1 billion. And he said, think about it. Then he said, you're ready to go back to work. And we went back. So he talked me off the cliff, then planted the idea, and then we went back to work. That's leadership, you know?
Yeah.
So I made the vow.
But listening to you talk about this, it occurred to me, the way that it hadn't, just reading your books, that you going to the garbage dump parallels in many ways what your mother was doing with the Clubmobile.
I think so. I mean, you know, to give you an idea of an extension of this, so Cindy and I have been on book tour now since May.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll see by the picture of my mom, there's it's in the slideshow too, there's a drawing of a woman shooting donuts out of a machine gun. It says, don't call me Dolly.
Uh-huh.
And that, we decided to honor their travels that we would drive it. Stupid idea. America's really freaking big.
Yeah. That's the thing about stupid ideas, is that you don't realize it's a stupid idea until it's too late.
Yeah, you're in the middle of it, and you think, oh my goodness. Yeah, we bought a really lovely hybrid SUV, all-wheel drive, and stuck the things on the door, and off we went.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, we're still going. Not driving anymore. Now it's the official fly to book festivals. But, yeah, we did 35 states.
Mm-hmm.
Probably about 50,000 miles.
So what going through that experience, and you know, you weren't dodging bombs and things like that.
No.
But still, all of the hours that you spent in a vehicle, and you have podcasts, and your mom and Jill did not have podcasts. But still, I imagine that would just get so tedious.
I understood. In fact,
boring.
Yeah.
At times.
Oh yeah. To borrow a phrase from Jill, the back of my lap told me that I got things right. Because after a while, you're like, I can't even get out of this thing.
I heard her say that one time.
The back of her lap.
The back of her lap.
I loved that. Yeah, it was a revelation, and to find so many people responding to it.
Mm-hmm.
And our heroic sisters, you know, I had no idea that would happen. That was life changing.
Yeah.
You know, I knew that the World War II gang had passed away. I'd never met any Korean war donut dollies. And then I heard that there were Vietnam era ones. Betsy, do you know Betsy in Colorado? So she talked to Cindy and they were gonna come to my event. And I thought, oh no, because what if I got things wrong? They would know. And you know, it was this close and they were all in the front row and they had blue t-shirts that says Vietnam donut dollies. And they sat there looking at me. And I thought, I'm not gonna look at them. I'm gonna talk to the audience. And every time I looked at them, they'd be like, so I thought, I'm busted. But they were the ones who presented the pin, you know? And then we had this fabulous lunch. And ever since then, you know, they have communication that my mom's generation wouldn't have had.
Yeah.
And, you know, people have shown up in New York, all over the country. It's so cool. And we had this revelation of a lunch with them.
Uh-huh.
And Cindy had a couple of them sat with Cindy, and I sat with four women at my end of the table. And I said, you're I think, a lot different than the World War II gang. And they said, well, yeah, we were gray slick, man. You know?
Yeah.
And I said, yeah, I didn't think about that. You know, they were young women in the 60s.
Yeah.
And
your mom fancied herself as Garbo. And
oh, yes, my mother. Sick. Oh, yes. That wasn't in this crew.
Uh-huh.
And it was so amazing just talking to them and realizing, you know. And I said, so it was different in Vietnam. She said, well, yeah, can you imagine trying to drive a GMC truck into the jungle full of donuts? Nah, we went in helicopters. And I said, wow. And she says, did you ever see Apocalypse Now? I said, yeah, wow, you know, change of perspective.
Yeah.
And they had really raunchy, hilarious stories.
Uh-huh. Naturally.
But the moment I felt that was super touching to me, because they'd known I'd had some health problems and I had had an operation. And they said, where'd they get you? And I said, in my throat. I said, do you have a scar? I said, well, they were careful. I had a little scar. And then they all started showing me their scars. Oh, yeah, look at this one. And the woman sitting next to me, she says, got a double mastectomy, but I don't think it's right to show it here in the cafe. And I thought, oh, my God, you know, I love you so much. So we stay in touch.
That's awesome.
And they want somebody, writers in the audience, to think about the history of their experience.
I like how you looked at me and then didn't look away. All right. I think we have time for one more question, and then we're going to open up to the audience. So I guess I have two questions, but they are...
You liar.
There, I know. I'm a really bad liar, by the way.
Me too.
Well, I guess that those are good qualities that we have, being bad liars.
Yes, we're.
It keeps us on the straight and narrow.
Yeah, we're hopelessly honest.
Yeah. Okay. So, when I said I had one question, I really meant I had two. I think I knew that the entire time. They're short questions, though.
Okay.
They could even, this is, you always hear if you're asking somebody a question, it should never be a yes or no question, but these are basically yes.
So this is the lightning round.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. In the book, are Irene's notebook entries your mother's actual notebook entries?
Some.
Okay. That's awesome.
And the letters are largely inspired by the ones Jill kept.
So the letters, I was going to ask you about that. At several points throughout the book, Irene and Dorothy get these letters from soldiers they served. Is that what you're talking about, that are letters Jill kept?
Jill's archives. My mom didn't keep any letters.
Okay.
Even Jill's.
Yeah.
I don't understand that. And Jill was assiduous in her collection of data.
Mm-hmm.
There was not supposed to be a boyfriend.
Yeah.
And, you know, the more we got to know Jill, the more we found out. And in fact, she had personal black notebooks, black albums.
Yeah.
On black pages. You remember those? And writing in white ink. Neat, meticulous. And I was going through it. Mm-hmm. Once again, I'm answering too much, but I want you to know. I was going through it. Cindy was over here. I was like, oh, look at this, look at this. Some of the stuff was really interesting, funny,
yeah,
whatever, eccentric. And I turned the page, and there's Mom at Cannes. You know, I said, oh, check her out. That's so cool. And I turned the page, and there's Mom at Cannes with his freaking GI all over her. And I said, what is that? Who is this? And Jill came over, and she leaned over, and she looked at the picture, and she said, oh, that's Jake. I said, Jake? Who's Jake? And she just looked at me, and she said, Lewis, it was a war.
The rules were different.
She said, we all had men. I was like, and, you know, that just sort of started developing. And there was another picture we found later with Jake.
Uh-huh.
The three women and that idiot in the back, you know? And he was a late development after Jill passed. We were allowed to spend some time, just the two of us with their stuff again, for, you know. And there was a letter. And it was a lovely letter, and it's partially in the novel. But this guy says, so how's Phyllis? Is she still head over heels for that fighter pilot, Jake? And I thought, oh my God, the dude was a fighter pilot, and it was a real thing.
Yeah.
So then I had to figure out a way to write about some torrid romance.
Uh-huh.
And you can't write that about your mom.
Right. But then if you make the guy like Gary Cooper, well, then really
it's in her eyes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the whole business, I won't go into it, but the whole business with the doorknobs at the end, that was true.
Yeah.
I don't know who that was in the doorknob, but I projected it must be Jake.
Wow. Well, I think that's a good note to end
okay.
on. And so we're going to open it up to the audience for questions. If you have a question, just raise your hand and someone will run a microphone to you. Any
right
questions?
Here, right here.
Okay.
I loved your book.
Thank you.
I even read the acknowledgments and author's notes and all of that
stuff. Oh, yeah, me too.
Oh, I love it. But I think it was there I saw something about on your webpage, there was a list of all the resources, and or at least some of the resources of the many, many, many you uncovered. But I couldn't find that.
Because I forgot to do it. But I will.
That would be
you know, great. It was such an avalanche of stuff. Yeah. And we met this amazing young woman who had gone through the archives at Harvard. Harvard has actually maintained some materials about the Clubmobile Corps. And so she wrote a critical, you know, PhD thesis. And thank God I didn't know about it till it was done. And Cindy, of course, found it. And I thought, oh no. But she confirmed all the stuff that's in the novel, which I thought, whew. So we became pals, and that was good. But yeah, there's so much material scattered, a lot of it, but we got as much as we could.
Hi, this is Maureen again. I wanted to ask, did your mom stay in touch with her family out east after she moved to California?
Not really. I only saw my grandmother once. She was very disapproving very difficult. And she died in New York. My mom flew back. And you might appreciate this. Knowing, if you've read the book, you'll understand how meaningful this was to me. Unexpected things happen to me all the time. So in 1982, I got hired to teach expository writing at Harvard. I went directly from a Mexican orphanage to the East Coast for the first time in my life. And I thought, I am going to die here. I don't know what I'm doing. This place, but a friend of mine had arranged it. He was partly in charge of the program. I stole all of his handouts and wrote my own handouts, copying what he'd said. And it was fantastic. Met Eudora Welty, John Irving. I mean, Harvard, for God's sake. So while I was there, my mother said, dear boy, she used to call me Lucci, darling. Do you think you could go down to Mattituck, Long Island? My family's there. I was like, really? Mattituck, Long Island? Yes, the Woodwards, they're there. And so my mentor used to go every summer and rent a house in the next town north from Mattituck. So he said, yeah, come on over. And I went down, took the train down, took the ferry across the Sound. He picked me up, and then he took me to Aunt Eva's house. And she was your dream of the cool 100-year-old auntie you didn't know you had. And she still pumped her own water, that kind of house. But it was the house my mom spent a lot of her girlhood in. She had my mom's encyclopedia still from probably 1918 or 1920. She had one of my mom's dolls, and she would tell old lady jokes. We would walk around the property, and she'd say things to me like, Lewis, what do cows do on Saturday night? I'd say, I don't know. Aunt Eva, what do they do? Why, they go to the movies.
That's so bad that it's fabulous.
It's wonderful. Yeah. I was like, you're really on. So when I had made a little money, I could buy my mom a ticket to Boston. And she came. And it was a total transformation. All of a sudden, she was wearing white gloves again and doing the gestures and saying to me things like, we must go have brunch at the Ritz, dear boy. Okay, Mom. You know, walking down the street, and she says, have you ever had Irish coffee? I said, no. Oh, you're going to like it. I said, okay. So I had her in my apartment, and she said, I want you to call Aunt Eva, and don't you dare tell, just furious, don't tell her I'm here. I just want to hear her voice. And I called her, and we're talking, and I'm looking at my mom, who's pouring tears, and I thought, I must betray her. Is that moment? And I said, Aunt Eva, someone's here who wants to talk to you. And I just handed her the phone. And I thought, she's going to kill me. And she said, Aunt Eva? And I could hear Aunt Eva saying, Phyllis, why did you never come home? So they made a date. And the next day, I took her to South Station. We took the train to Connecticut. She got on that same ferry. And she ended up living again in the home, taking care of Aunt Eva till she passed away. But my mom was never not my mom. So we get to the ferry, and she says, you know, Steinbeck took this ferry and travels with Charlie. I said, great, Mom. So, you know, there are some good things. So that's where all that Mattituck stuff comes in the book.
My father was in World War II when he was 18 years old.
Oh, boy.
And after he's passed and my mother, I have found a box of their letters to each other.
Wow.
From his parents, from his brothers, from my mother's brothers. And I just want to say, I feel so sorry for the youth today that they won't have that when they're old like us to sit and see that side of their parents. I mean, emails are fine, but it's kind of hard to get, you know, yeah, real excited over one.
Right. Old texts on a dead computer.
One day we'd gone on vacation, and I would be 8, 9. So my dad had been out of the service 10 years. And we're driving in Wisconsin, and there's a guy hitchhiking. And my dad slams on the brakes, throws it in reverse, and us three girls are going, "He's not sitting with us." And it was a guy my dad had been in the service with.
Man.
And you talk about, and you know, us three little girls were sitting there scared to death. And to me, it was so odd. But you know, 10 years isn't very long now. You remember your friends from 10 years
ago. Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
So I just wanted to say I enjoyed your book and the memoirs. And
thank you so much. You know, there were three women, and one of them was named Helen. Somebody over here had a hand up. There. And Helen wrote many letters back, and she's lived in Chicago. And I don't know what happened in her family, difficulties apparently. And they sold the letters on eBay. I think probably there was stuff there. So women, a married couple in San Francisco bought them. And they came to see Jill. And Jill called me and ordered us, "Get down here, you must meet them." So we had this wonderful gathering. And I'm hoping, because they said they were working on a book about Helen's experience, which is probably stuff I have no idea. Huh. Would be really cool to see. But yeah, that's a tragic loss. Yeah, and I talk to students a lot, and I always tell them, mark my words, you have a grandmother, an auntie, maybe your mom, who keeps telling you that damn story that you tune out over and over again. You're like, "Oh, not that again." Mm-hmm. And I promise them, that woman is going to leave you one day, and you're going to wonder, what was that story again? And you've lost a nugget of your own history that she was trying to share with you.
And now you can just record it with your iPhone.
Yeah.
So you should.
Yeah, you should. If you don't want to listen, at least record it.
Yeah.
Yes, I wanted to know, what did you want us to think of, or what did you want to convey to us about your mother in writing the book?
I wanted to convey the character of Irene. And, you know, if my mother and Jill both actually show up in the book. In fact, Irene and Dorothy sometimes play poker together, or they insult each other on the radio, just to keep my own psyche together, you know, because I'm thinking up an epic. I'm making Lawrence of Arabia or something. But I wanted to stay true and have them be witnesses to the story too, kind of keep me in line.
Yeah, I love that. And the fact that they, every so often, they just pop up in different ways.
Yeah.
And it's, even though, you know, you've talked about in the author's note and elsewhere, the fact that Irene and Dorothy were inspired by your mom and Jill, they're also not your mom and Jill.
Right.
And so having your mom and Jill just show up from time to time is a nice reminder of that.
It was very self-indulgent, but I loved having them there. And I think part of the point for me was everywhere I've gone, people didn't know, over and over again. And I think it's criminal that these heroes amongst us, I feel, didn't get their due. And I thought, who am I? But on the other hand, she's my mom. Mm-hmm. And then Miss Jill. So I thought, you know, I wanted to build a monument as best I could. People ask me, why didn't you write a nonfiction book? I said, well, because first of all, I think a novel is the most magnificent thing. And my mother loved novelists. Mm-hmm. You know, she loved Ernest Hemingway so much. Papa, and you know, Fitzgerald so much, all that. So I thought I'm going to try to do the greatest possible thing I could do for them. And sometimes it was agonizing. It was putting your feet in the fire because it's so painful. But yeah, and I was answerable to Cindy too, you know. I was. She was checking me all the whole way, and if there was a wrong step, we'd figure it out. There's somebody back there.
Yeah.
Nancy!
And this is gonna be our last question.
Yay! Not yay that it's the last, but yay that it's Nancy.
I wanted to remind people here that Jill was a great collector of memorabilia papers, and her World War II albums are now in the university archives.
Yeah.
So you can go over, you can search. And so everything you can do with the university archives here. And thank you very much to John Wilkin, the former university librarian who helped me with this process.
You can see Jake.
And all of his glory.
All of his glory.
So-called.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, everybody, for joining us. And I hope you can stick around. We're going to do a book signing out in the lobby. And we've also got an exhibit about Phil and Jill's World War II service. So I'm going to dash this man out the door. And then give us like a 60-second head start. And then you can start filing out. Yeah,
I'll turn.
Sure. Great idea.
That's
okay.
Brilliant.